Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the InfoWars Nightly News. I'm Darren McBreen. It is Friday, July 20th, 2012. Here's a quick look at what's coming up.
Tonight, Rob Dew speaks with a woman that was in an Old West showdown over smart meters encroachment on her property. Then, tragedy at the midnight premiere of The Dark Knight Rises. Breaking info as the PSYOP unfolds. Plus, the ATF director offers veiled threats to whistleblowers. All that and more on the InfoWars Nightly News.
All that and more coming up during the next hour, but first let's jump right into our top headlines as we begin this evening with the tragic Batman shooting in Aurora, Colorado, where political opportunists have already seized upon the incident to push for gun control. New York Mayor Bloomberg, predictably one of the first public figures to demand a crackdown on gun rights, as he has asked both Mitt Romney and Barack Obama to stand up and tell us what they're going to do about mass shootings. Now, more on Bloomberg later. But first, earlier today on the Alex Jones Show, Alex broke down how this incident and this shooting, it looks like a false flag attack. And, you know, there's no doubt that this has PSYOP written all over it. Here's Alex Jones.
It is Friday, the 20th day of July, 2012. And if you look at the full spectrum of information unfolding right now, 100% chance that the mass murder committed in the suburb of Denver, Colorado, right next to Littleton and Columbine, was a false flag mind control event. Of course, my quotes are on record from back in earlier in this month when I put a review out, 3 weeks ago or so, of The Dark Knight. And in that, I basically break down the fact that it is a weaponized propaganda psychological warfare system with subliminals commanding people to be in fear of terrorism, but also generating feelings of terror as a Hegelian dialectic event. Now, that nine-minute analysis is up at InfoWars.com right now. Now, yesterday, the makers of the film ordered the video taken down, even though we used the trailer, small clips, it's all fair use. We're analyzing it. They ordered it taken down. Now, normally, the computers would do that instantly when a video came up. If it really had copyrighted material, it's already set in the YouTube systems to recognize it and automatically... your video never goes live because it says copyright claim. We counterfiled and the block was taken off, so the video is available right now. Paul Watson wrote an article that was up at 6 a.m. Eastern this morning that was the first article to predict that Bloomberg, Chucky Schumer, Nancy Pelosi, and the usual suspects would come out and call for restricting the Second Amendment further, as they've done in Chicago and New York with total bans, thus creating hellish crime waves that dwarf what happened even on a weekly basis in Denver. There are more deaths in Chicago every week than what just died in the suburb of Denver. And sure enough, those reports have all now come out as the establishment calls for it. ABC News, the New York Times, Bloomberg himself, Bloomberg Publication, all the usual suspects, people that want to run your life, people that want to make you defenseless, so that somebody dressed up, by the way, in a Bane outfit, that's what he was wearing, a gas mask, came in there, and of course, with so many of these shootings, they're wearing masks, and then they find the drug-addled suspect later, just like Sirhan Sirhan. That's even mainstream news that the RFK shooter, the police's own report said he didn't shoot him, wasn't the same caliber. They held his hand down, and it was his, quote, security detail behind him that shot Robert F. Kennedy in the back. And that's London Telegraph, Associated Press, Reuters, LA Times. That's now admitted. Sirhan's lawyers are trying to get him out of prison with that defense. So this stuff goes on. They've got drugs they can give you, which make you close to 100% suggestible. In fact, you've seen this in the news where they've got flowers down in South America that you can give somebody and tell them, you know, put your hand in the meat grinder, drown your baby. In fact, I've got to get with my writers and have them explain that they've got drugs that make you, they say, 100% suggestible. I mean, not everybody's susceptible to this stuff. Some people have different effects with different drugs. But the point is, it's close to 100%. The military, it's declassified, uses this and then programs. Or they just drug somebody and then tell them they did the shooting and have them all set up. Columbine, we know, was a false flag. I'd say 100% false flag, and I'll explain why on the other side. You see, even if this was just an organic shooter, they were mass programmed by the culture that sells all this. I don't just get on air and say something's a false flag, a self-inflicted wound, a staged event. Because not all events are staged. But when you have the UN treaty set to be signed in the next week or two, Obama's not been clear. He said late July, early August. And they're talking about even if Congress doesn't ratify it, they're going to try to implement it somehow. It's just the right thing to do. Even though Congress won't do it, I'm going to implement it. Kind of like he's done with carbon taxes. They're only a couple votes shy in the Senate of being able to ratify the UN small arms ban treaty that even Forbes admits registers all your guns and then allows for confiscation. I had Bob Dacey in yesterday reading from the UN and from the treaty writers of how they would implement and what it meant. And saying in those documents, that video's up at Infowars.com, the history of UN gun control, gun restrictions is the name of the video, that they say at the end, we're going to use this as an arms treaty, so it's legally binding, to go after individual firearms. So you've got that coming up in the next 2 weeks. Just like they were trying to pass more gun bans in 99, and then magically Columbine happens in April, 1 week before the votes. We're talking miles from where this happened. You've got all the other issues. The guy's always wearing a mask. Whether it's these staged events the Russian government's been caught doing to bring in police state shootings. You have somebody drugged up, your people do the shooting, then they disappear, then they grab the patsy. The patsy's drugged out of their mind. Or sometimes, just like the underwear bomber was gotten on the plane by the State Department, that's C-SPAN, that's the Undersecretary of State admitting an unnamed agency told us give him a visa, even though he didn't have a passport, get him on the plane. We had a witness day one, Kurt Haskell, the lawyer, who saw this happen. And then a month after he told us here on the air and broke that, it got confirmed. Underwear bomber, gotten on the plane by British intelligence. Head of the 7-7 bombing, a SWAT. On record, MI6, London Telegraph, Fox News. Amir al-Awlaki, number three in Al-Qaeda, hanging out secretly at the Pentagon. Fox News, AP, Reuters. My point is that I worked with Watson right before we went live on air. We're doing another article right now breaking down the 10 points that directly link this to false flag. Because there's at least 10 of them. And this is where the shadow government is based, is in and around Denver. They control the police there. Harrison Kleibold of Columbine reportedly got 127 bombs. That's CBS News. Look it up. Into the building that day, the school was half empty. The police stood down. The police didn't respond for hours. People reported up to four different shooters. They wouldn't release the tape for over a year and only released selected clips, and there they were wearing masks. They'd shot a video of attacking the school months before that was school-sponsored. Their parents were both in high-level black ops. They were both on serotonin reuptake inhibitors. It all had the same MO of a black op, of a staged event. And remember, Sirhan, the LAPD and the coroner said didn't shoot RFK, and it did come out who shot him with his security detail, who was known CIA, who'd been assigned to the detail that day, behind him with a different caliber. The audio acoustics, all of it, the witnesses. Sirhan was given an amnesiac They give you an amnesiac, just like Baroness Vanderlube, who supposedly firebombed the Reichstag February 27, 1933, to bring in martial law in Germany. He was found naked and drugged and didn't know if he'd set fire to the building, like he was going to run around the Capitol building and set more than 14 fires in it. And Hermann Göring, though, don't worry, caught him and stopped him. The big hero, who it later came out in declassified documents, was the one behind it. They just finally released investigations that happened during Nuremberg. Those have been classified, but a lot of authors and researchers already knew. A few years ago, they released those. The point is, Hitler started World War II with Poland. Mainline textbooks just say, oh, he just attacked Poland. No, actually, he attacked military bases along the border, his own military bases, dressed up prisoners as Polish troops and as German troops, shot them up, and then shot newsreel footage and said Poland had attacked Germany with their World War I, pre-World War I military. It was horse-drawn carriages and guys with swords. Yeah, right. Most powerful military in the world at that time was German military, built in secret, pretty much. Secret rearmament. Rolled out, taking Danzig and other areas that had been taken by France at the end of World War I, and then they go into Poland and split it up with Uncle Joe Stalin. All done by a fake news story and shooting a few real people and then saying that they had attacked. Okay, that's how this is done. But so you can have a good patsy, like what you had with Giffords and Judge Roll, who were investigating, we've now confirmed, Fast and Furious, they were going to come out bipartisan together. They've got to be dealt with. Out comes a guy who was admittedly taking hallucinogens every day for years, hanging out with weird people, and had disappeared and told people he was under mind control. He shows up and shoots two people. They try to link it to the Tea Party. Then it turns out he was a out-of-his-mind person who was a Democrat. But that's, again, ladies and gentlemen, we're now being told by ABC and others, oh, he could be a Democrat, or no, he's Tea Party. And within hours, we predicted this. Paul Watson wrote an article this morning that's linked up on the right-hand side of DrudgeReport.com right now. Dark Knight shooting to be exploited for political grift. And then over the next few hours, AP, Reuters, CNN, Bloomberg, all of them coming out saying Obama and Romney both need to call to restrict guns. And by the way, Romney has supported that in the past. Now he says he doesn't, but now they're saying maybe this will give him the political courage to restrict people's Second Amendment. There's our article to be exploited for political grist under it. ABC News, right underneath that, already linking Tea Party. But backtracks now. Turns out he's a Democrat. Breitbart, shooter may be registered Democrat. CNN, Piers Morgan calls for gun control. Bloomberg, what are Obama, Romney going to do about guns? Not about a totally sick society that we see. And by the way, the London Telegraph got it right. They had a 12-month-old baby in there. They had little kids in there, six-year-olds in there, four-year-olds in there. A 12-year-old got shot and killed. The shooter reportedly shot a baby at point-blank range. All of this right before the treaty that's stalling in the Senate. Obama's about to sign it, and now he gets to be the hero. And by the way, don't worry. Don't worry. If a guy like dressed up like Bane shows up and does all this, shooting imitates scene from 1986 Batman comic book, where a guy in a mask like Bane shows up and shoots a bunch of people at a movie theater, and then they blame Batman. Oh, and see, the movie's now being blamed. Obama leads prayer moment of silence. Supporters chant four more years. Yes, this is the false flag rollout. And if you don't believe it, I got a bridge I'm ready to sell you. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a 9.5-minute video up at Infowars.com. Where I predicted Obama would do something like this. It's incredible.
Now we're going to flash back to a video that Alex Jones put together just a couple of weeks ago where he has analysis and predictions of the new Batman movie. The video you're about to watch was actually recently censored by YouTube. It was blocked inside the United States on copyright claims filed by Warner Brothers, despite its having, you know, we only use short promotional clips, and it was clearly fell in within the fair use guidelines and First Amendment free speech rights. But let's try it again. This is called Leaked, The Dark Knight Rises on the InfoWars Nightly News.
One of the most anticipated movies in a long time is about to come out. The Dark Knight Rises. Get ready because we are going to leak, spoil, and decode the new Batman film that's coming out. We're going to get into the meaning behind the meaning, the secrets behind the secrets. But first, understand, this is one of the most successful propaganda franchises out there selling tyranny. For all of you that say it's just a movie, for more than 50 years, the Department of Defense has paid and financed for most major action films. They all have a unified propaganda message, selling you on the idea that you're powerless and that you can't protect yourself. Only shadowy groups, by violating your rights and liberties, can keep you safe. Throughout the Batman franchise, any vigilantes other than Batman are powerless, pathetic, fat, stupid, or psychopathic. To understand the conclusion of the Dark Knight series, we first have to go back to the beginning. In Batman Begins, a secret society known as the League of Shadows, led by Ra's al Ghul, played by Liam Neeson, seeks to put a poisonous psychotropic drug in the water supply to drive Gotham, the archetypal New York, into total insanity. Then he will bring order out of the chaos. And as all informed people know, governments have been fluoridating water supplies for more than 60 years, causing brain damage and cancer. So we see here in the first installment a revelation of the method or the power structure showing you how they operate. That there are secret societies that manipulate for good and bad. Bruce Wayne, the aristocrat, the banker, the globalist, has his secretive system. And then there's the evil outlanders trying to come in and take over. In part two, Batman, The Dark Knight, we're introduced to the Joker. Now let's analyze the underlying messages here. He is a nonconformist, a libertarian type who makes his own clothes and burns money.
Nothing. No matches on prints, DNA, dental, clothing is custom, no labels.
He doesn't go along with the mainline consumerist corporate culture. And so he's got to be a murdering psychopath who enjoys blowing up hospitals, bridges, ships, and killing police officers. But our hero, the rich banker industrialist Bruce Wayne, have developed a system to hack into cell phones and use them to create a sonar system that can give them a three-dimensional view of what's happening by using Defense Department technology they were developing to hack into all the cell phones and use them as audio microphone systems. They're able to save the city because they violate everyone's rights and spy on them without warrants. So again, it aids and abets and gives comfort to criminal elements in the NSA who on record are spying on the American people and using all of our appliances from smart meters to computers to smartphones to spy on us. All of it is pro-tyranny propaganda. We now move from part two to part three. The Dark Knight Rises. So let's start decoding The Dark Knight Rises. Number one, look at the name, The Dark Knight Rises. And we're told that he's willing to give it all up.
You've given them everything.
Not everything. Not yet.
Oh, you've already given these people so much.
I haven't given everything.
So he's this Christ figure this dark Christ who is fighting the evil secret society led by Bane, who is coming to destroy Babylon, the beautiful city. Here's a few juicy spoilers. Batman gets his back broken in a fight with Bane. At the end, as Bane is dying, we learn that he's a Darth Vader character who can't survive without the mask, which is the recurring cyborg archetype that humanity can't live without machines. Who is Bane? He's a symbolic demon, a destroyer, a symbol of the Hegelian dialectic, order out of chaos. To the conscious mind, these symbols don't register. But to the subconscious, they are clear commands, just like you're a computer. The power of Hollywood, the power of images to program the mind is not debated. And the Pentagon and Madison Avenue know that. Remember back in 1975, when for more than 2 years, the beaches were almost empty in the United States and areas of Europe and Australia because people were so scared that a giant shark was going to eat them? Psychological warfare chiefs certainly paid attention to that. Even though on average, less than 5 people die a year from great white shark attacks worldwide, people would not go in the water and were demanding shark patrols and more lifeguards for a non-existent threat. And that's what these movies do, not just these Batman films. Every one of these films has terrorists blowing up major cities constantly to create the psychological illusion that there's big sharks out there that want to eat you, and there's terrorists under every table that want to attack you and your family. And you notice at the end of Jaws, the shark has been killed. He's been defeated. But still, the beaches remained empty. You are being subconsciously programmed. When you go in one of these movies and just turn yourself over to it and suspend a disbelief, you become a willing victim to have your mind literally programmed in that key fear state. Because when the mind is in that fear state, it is wide open to be reprogrammed. And now in the new film, we see the football game blown up. We see the police helpless if the state doesn't take every right we've got and turn our children against us and set up highway checkpoints and launch 30,000 armed drones and listen to our phone calls, then none of us are safe, because the non-existent threat of Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda and Bane are going to get us. The key to understanding why the social engineers want males in an arrested development junior high mentality state is simple. Through thousands of films and video games, we are bombarded with the idea that threats always come in the form of a giant evil monster or terrorist who openly announces themselves, not through slow cultural death. And men are presented with an idea of Arnold Schwarzenegger, the Herculean figure, or somebody like Batman, defeating the enemy all by themselves because the public is powerless. That's why now when I talk to so many men, they say, oh, you're such a hero. You go out and confront politicians. You go out and, you know, fight for freedom. I'm glad you're there. What do you mean? I'm just an average person like you. We're not fighting big green Martians from Mars. We're not fighting shadowy groups like Bane, unless you talk about the private Federal Reserve that's hijacked this country. We're fighting the New World Order. We're fighting a corporate takeover system with regulations and red tape that doesn't announce itself as an enemy, but that just oozes in with bureaucracy to dominate and usurp our lives. We're fighting the UN and Agenda 21 and a federal government bought and paid for by foreign interest engaging in treason. When you're conscious or awake, aware, watching, when you don't suspend your disbelief, you see the programming, the manipulation, the hypnotic suggestions right there like it's written on the wall. But when you're unconscious, like the general population, you are wide open to be victimized by this programming. Hey, I like a good action adventure and movie as much as the next person. There's nothing wrong with enjoying a film if you're aware of the implanted images. But it's important that people become conscious of the manipulation that's going on. So please share this presentation with your friends and family and visit InfoWars.com/Batman. Batman, where we've posted some other examples of brainwashing that are taking place in our culture.
Now, Alex Jones will be posting updates on this story all weekend long as the story develops. So be sure to check out Infowars.com for updates as they happen. Now, meanwhile, earlier we were talking about Mayor Bloomberg, and within hours of the shooting, the New York mayor rushed to exploit the tragedy and try to crush our right to self-defense. With more on this story, we now take you to Infowars Nightly News reporter David Ortiz.
Thank you, Darren. I'm David Ortiz. In the hours, days, and weeks ahead, we can expect a concerted attack on the right to own firearms and the Second Amendment in response to the shooting in Colorado last night. Proponents of disarming the public will argue that restricting the right to own firearms will prevent mass murders and violence. But here's something they will not tell you. The chance you will be a victim of a mass shooting is at best minuscule. According to the Bureau of Justice Statistics, the proportion of homicide incidents involving two victims has increased slightly from 2.7% in 1980 to 3.7% in 2008. So basically, within about a 30-year window, that number has barely increased. Here are some more numbers. According to the Bureau of Justice Statistics, 3.7% of all homicides involved two victims, 0.5% involved three victims, 0.2% involved four victims, and 0.1% involved five or more victims. So obviously, mass murders are rarely happening, yet they continue to want to gun grab the government. Moreover, the homicide rate in the United States has declined sharply in recent years from 9.3 homicides per 100,000 in 1992 to 4.8 homicides per 100,000 in 2010. So this is obviously far from an epidemic, yet the government wants control of your guns. And here's one of the reasons why. I'm going to give you some quick stories. A 71-year-old recently was at a gaming cafe in Florida. Two intruders came in, one with a bat, one with a gun. They wanted to rob the place. He shot a gun, and the perpetrators ran away. And as a result, one bystander says, "I think he is wonderful for doing what he did, for protecting us." And that could actually be seen on YouTube, from what I'm told. Another example of law-abiding citizens protecting themselves with a gun. In Phoenix recently, a 14-year-old boy protected his three younger brothers from an intruder who broke into their home with a gun. He shot at the intruder with his father's gun, and he struck the intruder, and the intruder ran away. That recently happened in Phoenix. And just another story that recently happened in Oklahoma City. A woman was able to protect both herself and her child. An intruder came in, tried to kick in her door. He came at her with a knife, and her name, Mrs. McKinley, she took out her 12-gauge, and she shot the perpetrator and was able to save the life of both her child and herself. But the government would say that's evil. It's, you know, she was wrong, obviously. So those are just some great examples, and you don't see that in the media. Examples of people protecting their loved ones because they used a firearm. Let me end with this. It's a quote from Ben Franklin, and it said, "Those who would give up essential liberty to purchase a little temporary safety deserve neither liberty nor safety." And later on in the show, Rob is going to interview a woman who exercised her Second Amendment rights. That's going to be a great piece. So back to you, Darren.
Thank you, Dave, for that report. And what an amazing coincidence that this Dark Knight massacre just happens to occur within weeks away from, and only a few more votes needed in the Senate to pass the UN Small Arms Treaty. After all, our government is filled with lawmakers who endorse a one world government with the UN as the single governing agency for the globe. So when this treaty comes before the U.S. Senate, you know, they're most likely going to support it, especially now following the shooting in Colorado. And the UN has been planning this for a very long time. I mean, just look at the statue that's in front of the UN building in New York. That's a .357 revolver right there. There you go. That's a .357 revolver with the barrel tied in a knot. It's not a broken missile. It's not a broken bomb. That is blatant, in-your-face, small arms control.